Welcome to New Hope Online. Let's take out our Bibles and your iPad, iPod, or your Android tablet, or whatever you use to read your Bible. And let's turn to one of my favorite books in the New Testament. It's the book of Philippians. And today we are going to put our focus on chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. I'm talking today about how do you handle anxiety and stress? How do you deal with it? What do you do when the situation that you are in seems to be just too much for you and you are overwhelmed by anxiety and your heart and mind and soul is filled with stress? How do you handle it? How do you deal with it? Well, that's the subject of my message for today. This is what the Bible says to us in the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Look what it says. It says, be careful for nothing. What does that mean? It simply means, don't worry about anything. That's what it means. Be careful for nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And then look what verse 7 says. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. And then we get to verse 8. Look what it says. And Paul says, finally, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, Paul says, think on these things. Think on these things. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, Eon Thomas said long ago, I can't, you never said I could, but you can, and you always said you would. And so that's all I need to know, Heavenly Father. And so I would ask you now to just come and anoint what I'm about to say today. I pray that you would eliminate any distractions that anyone might have as they listen to what you have to say to them through your written word. I pray, Lord, bottom line, that someone listening today will get a handle on how to deal with stress and anxiety. And Father, I pray that you would do your work as the Holy Spirit comes to hover over us for these next few moments. And for all you do, we are going to give you glory, honor, and praise. For I pray with a grateful heart, in the name of Jesus, amen. I'm talking to you today about how to handle anxiety and stress. Now, oftentimes, as I study the Bible, I come across issues that I'm personally dealing with. And so I was thinking that if I'm dealing with this situation of how to handle anxiety and stress in my own life, then chances are pretty good that someone else also is dealing with this same issue. And if you're not, chances are really good that in the future, you just may be finding yourself in a situation that's causing you a lot of anxiety and stress. So, how do you deal with stress and anxiety? How do you handle it? Well, in my research this week, I learned that Americans deal with stress and anxiety in their lives seven different ways. Number one, they listen to music. Number two, they exercise. Number three, they read. Number four, they spend time with family and friends. And number five, they spend 2 hours watching television. And number six, they take a nap. Number seven, they play video games or surf the internet. For me, what helps me to put a handle on my anxiety and stress is I listen to music. I have a wide variety of music to listen to depending upon what mood I happen to be in at the given time, all the way from praise and worship to classical country music or whatever. So I listen to music and I work in my flower gardens, and that helps me to reduce to some extent anyway the anxiety and stress that I find myself in. So what is anxiety? Let's define what we are talking about today. It's a feeling of worry. It's nervousness or unease, typically about an imminent event or something with an uncertain future. It's that uncertain future that causes anxiety and stress. Some symptoms that worry and anxiety is controlling our lives is fear. Sometimes we have problems sleeping. Sometimes we wake up in the middle of the night with sweat, unable to sleep. Sometimes we have a shortness of breath. And sometimes we just can't seem to be still. We just can't be still. I'll tell you what, folks, I've said it many times. At New Hope, we share good news that you can use. The Word of God addresses every single issue that we face in our lives. Michael Smith wrote a song, "Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above Him there is no other. Jesus is the way." Actually, he did not write that song, but he put the words to music, and he made a song out of that. Lyrics that someone else wrote. But everything we need, folks, is found in Jesus. If we can just get a handle on that, everything that we face and need in life is found in Jesus. And the answer for every problem that comes into our lives, the answer is found in the Bible. And you know what? Jesus knew that we were going to be struggling in this area of anxiety and stress. So he addressed some of the things that we are going to be anxious and worried about. You know, I've studied the Bible most of my life. Actually, I became a Christian when I was a young teenager at a youth camp. But as I studied the Bible, especially on this one issue, I come to realize that the number one thing that we have a tendency to worry about, the number one thing that causes a lot of anxiety in our lives, is the very thing that Jesus is talking about. And it's the very first thing that Jesus addresses. The number one thing that people just like you and me are worried about is finances. If money problems are keeping you awake at night, you're not alone, because statistics in my research reveals that more than half, 56% of adults lose sleep at night over at least one money-related issue. Furthermore, of those who are tossing and turning, 18% are doing so because of credit card debt, which is the number one reason why people are losing sleep. And Jesus knew that. He knew that would be our number one area of struggle. He knew that we would be controlled to a certain extent by finances. And this is what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. He said, "No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate one and love the other, or else he will hold to one and despise the other." You can't serve God and mammon. Now, I researched that word mammon, and here's what it means. The New Testament, folks, was written in Greek. And here's the best translation that I found in my research. The best translation for mammon is stuff. That's what it means, stuff. And he said, Jesus did, that you can't worship me and stuff. And we live in a world, folks, when we have so much stuff, and we worry about our stuff, and we worry about getting more stuff, and we worry about keeping our stuff. And you know what a lot of folks do? Here's what we do. This is crazy, but here's what we do. We buy things we don't need to impress people we don't like, because we've got to keep up with the Joneses. The only problem with that theory is that once we catch up with the Joneses, you know what they do? They refinance. They refinance. But we've got to have our stuff. Your children and my children make up 3% of the world's population. But you know what? They own 40% of the world's toys. We've just got to have our stuff. We've got to have bigger houses so we can get more stuff, and we worry about our stuff. And Jesus said, the number one thing you are going to worry about is finances. You say, well, the economy is good or the economy is bad, depends upon who you listen to. But even in a good economy, we still worry about our stuff. Am I going to run out? Is my 401k going well? Is my retirement okay? So we worry about stuff. And Jesus said, so you're going to be worrying about stuff. You're going to be worrying about finances. And then Jesus says, there's a second thing that we worry about. These are the things that American people worry about. These are the things that you and me worry about. One is finances, and number two is fashion. We worry about fashion. In my research, folks, I found out that teenagers are more stressed over fashion than we adults are. Teenagers are literally stressed out over peer pressure and fashion, looking to be in the in crowd, wearing clothes that are in style. Fashion. We worry about it. And Jesus addressed it. Look what he said. He said, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on it. Notice he says, for your body, what you shall put on it. A young lady was serving in Iraq, and she called her mom, and she said, Mom, can you mail my makeup kit to me really quick, because the people over here really don't know what I really look like. She was worried about fashion while she was fighting in a war. Can you believe that? I learned something this week that actually blew my circuits, folks. It shocked me, to tell you the truth. Here's what I learned. In my research, I learned that the average woman disposes of 65 pounds of clothing every year. 65 pounds of clothing. Can you believe it? I'm getting rid of that, the average woman says. The average woman has 30 outfits in her closet. And I'm getting rid of that. Can't wear it anymore. Doesn't fit. So when I read that statistic, I found that really hard to believe, because I know most people, human nature is, well, I'm not going to dispose of that. I'm just going to tuck it away over in the corner of my closet. Then when I lose weight, I will be able to wear it again. So we worry about fashion. We worry about finances. And Jesus says there's a third thing that we worry about. And most Americans worry about number three as well. We worry about fitness. We're into fitness. We've got to stay fit, so we say. And if we're not into staying fit, then what do we do? Well, we worry about our health. You know, life is fragile, folks. And on any given day, we take the risk of losing our health. So a lot of us worry about our health. Kind of like the guy that got braces put on his false teeth because he wanted to stay fit. Can you believe that? But Jesus addressed it. Look what he said in verse 27. He said, "Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to his stature?" So we worry about our fitness, worry about our finances. We worry about fashions. A lot of Americans do, including you and including me. Number four, we worry about family. We worry about family. We worry about our children. We worry about our grandchildren. We worry about the world in which they are going to grow up in. We worry about what's going to happen to them. We worry about them becoming addicted to social media. We worry about the friends that they choose. Are they good friends? Or are they bad influence for them? So we worry about our family. We worry about our grandchildren. And then the fifth thing that we worry about is the future. We worry about the future. And guess what? Jesus addressed that issue as well. Look what he said in verse 34. He said, "Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough of its own." That's what Jesus said. And so he said, don't worry about the future. So what do? We worry about the future. Are we going to be involved in a nuclear war? Some of the times we watch the news, we think we ought to build a bunker and be prepared to go in it at any time. What's going to happen in the future? Well, only God knows. I heard the other day that an individual said that they were going to live to be 115. And I said, well, that's great. That person knows more about God, more about life than God does. The best way to define how long we will live here on this earth is what the psalmist said. He said, "My times are in the Lord's hands." God knew when we would be born, and God knows when the curtain will come down on the final minute of our lives. But we worry about the future. We worry about what's going to happen. A lot of us are very concerned and worried about the upcoming election in November and the consequences of how the vote will turn out. We worry about our retirement. Will it be there when we are ready to retire? We worry about life itself. What's going to happen if I die? What's going to happen to me if my wife dies? What's going to happen to me if my husband dies? What's going to happen? We're so worried about the future. Jesus addressed everything, folks. Jesus, it's amazing. He knew what we would be overwhelmed with, these issues that he addresses on the Sermon on the Mount. He addressed everything, folks. Jesus addressed every single issue that we worry about, that we're stressed out about, that we are full of anxiety about. He addressed every single one of these issues. And guess what? Jesus not only addressed these issues, he knew what we were going to be worried about, but in his goodness and in his grace and in his mercy, he tells us a plan to overcome anxiety and worry. By the way, think about it. Am I really giving a good testimony, folks, if I am anxiety driven in my relational world, and I'm the one who's supposed to know the Prince of Peace? Look what Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6 says. It says, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. And I did some research on that phrase, Prince of Peace. And you know what it actually means? It means tranquilizer. That's what it means. So what kind of a testimony am I giving, folks, if I'm always stressed out, if I'm overloaded with anxiety, if I'm always anxiety-driven, always worrying? By the way, let me just say this. I've discovered and I have learned that worry is a sin. Now, there are things that we know are sin that we wouldn't even think about doing, but somehow we think that it's okay to worry. Not so. Get this down. Worry is a sin. To be consumed with worry is not pleasing to God. The Bible says, whosoever is not of faith is sin. And so worry is sin, folks. It really is, and it's not pleasing to God. So, how do I handle anxiety and stress? How do I deal with these worries? Well, I tell you what, in the book of Philippians, by the way, the book of Philippians happens to be one of my favorite books in the New Testament. And chapter 4, verses 6 to 8, we find that Jesus not only identifies the things that we are going to be worrying about, that we are stressed out about, that we are overwhelmed with anxiety about, Jesus not only knew that we would be concerned with these issues that I've just described, but he's such a good God, folks. He also has developed a plan that we can work, whereby we can not worry and not be overrun by anxiety and stress, but because we know who Jesus is, the Prince of Peace, tranquilizer. And in the book of Philippians, chapter 4, he gives us his plan, how we can overcome anxiety and stress in our lives. And folks, I hope you take good notes and write these steps down, because they work. And the reason I know that they work is because I have worked them over these long years of pastoring. They work. And this is good news that you can use. So 5 steps to get a handle on anxiety and stress. Here they are. Number 1, refuse to worry about anything. Now we need to understand something. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 26, he said it in verse 25, he said it in verse 31, and he said it in verse 34. 3 times Jesus said, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. Now listen up. When your mate tells you something 3 times, do you kind of get the message? I sure do. And Jesus says, don't worry. Now get this. God will not ask us to do something if it was impossible to do. He's not that kind of a God. God will not ask us to do something that we couldn't do. God is not that kind of a God, folks. He is not going to tell you to do something if it's impossible for you to do it. So, we get back to the verse. Refuse to worry about anything. Look at verse 6. Don't worry about anything. Now, your greatest concern, whatever it is, could be finances, could be fitness, could be fashion, could be family, could be future, whatever it is, I want you to write that down. Don't worry about anything. And beside anything, I want you to write down the number one thing or things that you are worried about. Put it down on paper. Write it down. This is what I have done over these long years, and this is what I have done once again this past couple of four weeks when we are in this pandemic crisis. This is what I have done. I have put it down on paper. This is my greatest concern. This is what is keeping me awake at night, or trying to. And so I write it down. I identify what I'm worrying about. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to write down. Don't worry about fill in the blank. Write it down. And I don't care what it is. God said that we are not supposed to worry about it. God says, do not worry 3 times. Now here's what's interesting. I'm convinced, folks, there are 3 things that we tend to worry about. Number one, we tend to worry about decisions. You say, Dale, I got some very important decisions to make. And you know what? I say, good. God gives us a plan for making good decisions. And you say, well, Dale, I'm really stressed out over making this decision. I want to make sure I make the right decision. By the way, folks, when you are in a situation when you need to make a decision, the worst place you can find yourself in is not making any decision at all. Because when you're in that situation, nothing changes. So you have to move out of that no decision arena. And sometimes we have to make a decision so that we can find the right decision. Does that make sense? Sure makes sense to me. So when you are dealing with decisions, God gives us a plan. God is so good, folks. We sing that song a lot, but do we really mean it? God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. And when there's an issue that we are facing, God has a plan. And here's the plan on making decisions, good decisions, wise decisions. It's found in the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. He said, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do, and He will show you which path to take. Trust in the Lord, King James says, with all of your heart, and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. That's one of the very first verses I memorized when I started memorizing Scripture years ago, back in my teenage years. And He will show you the path to take when you acknowledge Him. So what is God saying here? He is saying, you come to me. You give that decision to me. Not what you want, but what I want for your life. And what I want for my life and what God wants for my life oftentimes are 2 different things. But He said, when you're making a decision, you give that decision to me. And I will make it crystal clear which path you should go in. Now, some people say, well, give me 10 steps in finding God's will for my life. I got news for you, folks. There aren't 10 steps for finding God's will for your life. That might surprise you, but it's true. There's only one plan in finding God's will for your life. The only one is when you surrender your will to God's will. It's when you make a decision. You want what God wants for your life more than what you want for your life. And when you come to that decision where you surrender your life to Jesus, and you want what He wants for your life, then you will be in the will of God. That's how it works. Then there's the second thing we tend to worry about, and that is provision. Provision. And the reason that we worry about provision is because we doubt God's power. Look what Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 12 says. He has made the earth by His power. He made the earth by His power. I've said this before, and it bears repeating. He didn't begin when the beginning began. He began the beginning. He didn't start with start. He started start. He made everything by His power. Folks, we have a great God, and He has an abundance of power. But you know what we do? Sometimes we doubt God's power. And then there's a second thing that we worry about is the issue is that we doubt that we really matter to God. Out of all these people, 7 billion people in this world, how in the world could God love little old me? So we say, I'm not some special person. I'm not in the in crowd. And so we doubt that we matter to God. And we even doubt that God could forgive us. After all, Dale, if you only knew the dark side of my life, some of the terrible things I've done, mistakes I've made, wrong turns I've made in the road, how could God possibly love me after all that I have done wrong in my life? Well, I got good news for you, folks. I got really good news for you. Look what the Bible says. It says, behold, the fowls of the air, they sow not, neither do they reap, and your heavenly Father feeds them. Are they not much more better than they? Listen to this. Behold, the fowls of the air, talking about the birds, they sow not, neither do they reap, and gather into barns, and your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much better than they? Folks, I've said this before. God did not create birds in His image. God did not give birds dominion over the earth. God did not allow His Son Jesus to go to the cross and die for the birds. But He made you and He made me in His image. And let me tell you something, folks. If God can take care and feed the birds, then He is going to take care of you and provide provision for you and for me. So, as I've said before, when you are stressed out, go outside and take a look at the birds. God cares for them. God feeds them. And aren't you and me more valuable than the birds? Sure we are. When we left our first pastorate in Mansfield, Washington, back in 1973, at the last service we held in that church, a woman with a beautiful voice sang a song, and she dedicated it to Mary Ann and me. The name of the song was, God Will Take Care of You. God will take care of you. And as she sung that song, she pointed to Mary Ann and me sitting in the audience. And I can say over all of these years, God kept His promise. God has taken good care of us, and He will continue to take good care of us, because our anchor holds in these troubled times, and it's anchored to the solid rock, which is Christ Jesus. And so what you need to realize is, God would actually bankrupt heaven if it took that to meet your needs and my needs. And we need to realize something, folks. I've said this 101 times over the years. Where God guides, He provides. I have several stories I could tell, time permitting, about that statement that I just made, where in actuality, it did happen. Where God guides, He provides. Where God leads, He succeeds. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible says, God has never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread, and He is going to supply all your need, and no good things will He withhold from them that walk uprightly. We have a good God. God is good all the time. All the time. God is good. You might want to break out and sing that song. We're stressed out over decisions that we make. We're stressed out over the provision that God is willing to make for us. And then something else, we're stressed out because of lack of wisdom. Jesus took all of these things that we Americans worry about, are stressed out about, are overwhelmed with anxiety. That includes you and that includes me. He took all of these things. He knew that we were going to be experiencing this crisis of not knowing how to handle anxiety and stress, but in His goodness and in His mercy and in His providential, watchful care over us, He has devised a plan on how to handle it. Look at verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. What things is He talking about here? He's talking about finances. We give it to Jesus. We give it to Jesus as an acknowledgement that Jesus controls our finances. We learn to give Him back 10%. That's called the tithe of all income that comes into our coffers. Marianne and I made a decision when this pandemic crisis hit way back in March that we would continue to tithe, and we still continue to tithe. Give God your checkbook, my friend. Give God your time. Give God your talent. And look what He will do with your moments of anxiety and your stressful moments. So all things, that includes finances, that includes fashions, that includes fitness, that includes family, that even includes the future. The definition of worry, it means to divide, it means to pull apart. Connotation is like taffy candy being stretched and pulled apart. It means to be torn apart. And what worry does, it actually literally just tears you apart. It divides you. So, how do you handle it? You get single focused, and you focus on God and seeking what God wants. And He says, you know what, when we do that, you'll wake up in the morning and everything else will take care of itself if we focus upon God. What God says, what's He saying here? Don't worry about anything. Okay, Dale, how do we not worry about anything? Number two in His plan, talk to God about everything. Talk to God about everything. See, when something happens that is stressful in your life, you talk to God about it. Here's what you do. When you are overwhelmed with stress and anxiety, our first inkling ought to be, I've got to talk to God about this. I want to go and talk to God. I want to have a talk with Jesus. I'm not going to the phone. I'm going to the throne, folks. I'm going to go to God. I want to talk to Him about this. Now, there's a third thing that He tells us to do. Part of the plan here is you thank God in all things. You thank God in all things. Develop the attitude of gratitude is what He's talking about here. I saw something for the very first time in my study of the book of Philippians that I had never seen before. Has that ever happened to you? You can read a chapter or a verse many, many times, and all of a sudden something pops out at you that you hadn't seen before. Well, that happened to me this past week when I read Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6. And here's what it says. It says, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by supplication and thanksgiving. Now, here's what's interesting. I always thought, well, that verse meant that when we are praying, we ought to think of the things that we ought to be thankful for. But I'm convinced that there's more there than just that. Look what Jesus did when He prayed. This is what I learned for the very first time, believe it or not, this past week in preparing this message. Look at John chapter 11, verses 41 and 42. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus, look what He did. He lifted up His eyes and said these words, Father, I thank You that You have heard me, and I know that You always hear me. Get this. When Jesus went to pray, He started simply by saying, Lord, I thank You that You are hearing me right now. Wow, that was a revelation for me. When you come to God with your stressful situation, begin your prayer the way Jesus started His prayer. Father, I thank You that You are hearing me, and You always will hear me. So here's what you do. You take that stressful situation to God, and we take it to Him, and we say, Lord, I thank You that You are hearing me right now. Thank You, Lord, that You are hearing me right now. And then you start telling Him about that stressful situation that you find yourself in. And when you pray that prayer right at the very beginning, before you ask God for anything, Heavenly Father, I thank You that You are hearing me right now as I give to You my stressful situation. And when you start your prayer with that introduction, I'll tell you what happens. It will build your faith, and it will build your confidence, and it will strengthen your heart and your faith. When you just thank Him, Lord, I thank You that You are hearing me right now. Now, here's the way it works. Kind of bow your head. You don't have to bow your head. But God, I have this situation, and I'm bringing it to You. It could be finances. That's the number one thing we worry about, so let's talk about it. Lord, I'm bringing to You my finances. I don't know if my 401k is going to be there when I retire. I don't know if any money will be there when I do retire. And I just thank You, Lord, that You are hearing me right now as I express to You the stressful situation that I'm in at this moment. You know what happens, folks? When you do that, look at Psalm 116, 1 and 2. Look what it says. He says, I love the Lord because He hath heard my voice. He hath inclined His ear unto me Therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. What does that mean? Here's what it means. Lord, I've got this situation. And Lord, it's heavy on my heart. But I want to thank you first and foremost that you are hearing me. I want to thank you, Lord, you are listening. You are hearing what I have to say. And then look what happens. Psalm 116, 1 and 2. Look what happens. The Bible says when we pray that kind of a prayer, he leans his ear unto us. He leans his ear unto us. He inclines his ear unto us. Years ago in church, many, many years ago, after our morning prayer, the choir would sing, "Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and give us your peace." Kind of all key there, but you get the message. God is listening. He is saying, bring it on, bring it on. I want to help you. Talk to me. He's listening. And you say, Lord, thank you that you are hearing my prayer. There's the fourth thing, folks. Five steps to handling anxiety and stress. Number four, think about good things. Think about good things. He tells us in verse 8, look at it. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. What's he saying here? He is saying it is so important what we think about. Job said this in Job 3, verse 25. He says, the things that I greatly feared is come upon me. That which I was afraid of is come unto me. Children of God, we should be expecting good things. That psalm keeps popping up again. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. Shouldn't we be children of the Most High of God? Be expectors of good things? Sure we should. Look at this verse in Psalm 5. And verse 3, here's what it says. My voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning will I direct it to you, and I will look up. What do we do when things seem to overwhelm us with anxiety and stress? We have a tendency to look down. And yet the psalmist says, look up. We ought to be like the man who was 90 years old, and he bought a house in a good school district, and he got married. He was expecting good things to happen in his life, and we ought to be expecting good things to happen in our lives, folks. I like the story of Elijah and Ahab in 1 Kings chapter 18. I don't know if you've ever noticed this or not. There had been a 3.5 year of a drought. No rain. It was dry. Man went out and caught a catfish. And there are two ticks on it. I mean, the country was bone dry. Look at verse 41. And Elijah came and said unto Ahab, get something to eat and drink, for I hear a mighty rainstorm coming. Now, like the King James Version says, I hear the sound of an abundance of rain. Then he climbed to the top of Mount Carmel and he prayed. But wait a minute. Before he prayed, he said, I hear the sound of an abundance of rain. And I see a cloud off in the distance, the size of about a man's fist. Elijah was expecting a thunderstorm, a rainstorm. Folks, Elijah was expecting good things even before he prayed. That's interesting. Folks, we are children of the Most High God, and we should not go around expecting bad things to happen. We ought to go around expecting good things to happen. Why? Because we are children of God. A dad took his 16-year-old daughter to a Major League Baseball game, and dad said, well, let's get one of those delicious hot dogs. The daughter said, Dad, I don't have any money. And dad said, honey, did you bring any money? And the daughter said, no. She didn't need to bring any money because she was dependent upon her sugar daddy to supply the funds to buy that hot dog. Think about this, folks. Do you realize that Matthew chapter 7, verse 11, here's what it says. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? We ought to be expecting good things, folks. We need to look up and not look down. We ought to be expecting good things to happen in our lives. A lady walked up and she said, excuse me, sir, but you look like my third husband. The guy said, oh my goodness, how many times have you been married? And she replied, twice. And she was expecting good things to happen. Don't you think? Sure she was. Good things will happen when we look up and not down and keep our anchor solid upon the Lord Jesus Christ. We serve a good God, folks. Number five, be content with anything. Be content with anything. John Wooden said, things work out best for those who make the best of how things work out. Things work out best for those who make the best of how things work out. Talking about contentment here now, folks. Philippians 4, chapter 11. Paul says, for I have learned in whatever circumstances I find myself in to be content. You know what? Most people don't enjoy life because they are afflicted with this destination disease. And what I mean by that is you're going to be happy when you reach a certain point in your life. You're going to be happy when you make the move to a new community. You're going to be happy when you get that new job. Some say, I'm single, and I'll be happy when I get married. And my answer is, no, you won't. If you're not happy now, what makes you think you're going to be happy when you get married? What actually will happen, 9 times out of 10, because you're unhappy now, you make someone else unhappy. So that doesn't work. What is contentment? Contentment is simply enjoying what I have right now. Which tent do you live in, by the way? Do you live in the tent of content, or do you live in the tent of discontent? Waiting for something to happen in order to make you happy. Let me say this as I wrap up this message. Quit comparing. Don't do it anymore. If you don't remember anything else I've said today, remember this, quit comparing. Comparison is the killjoy to your life. It's the death of your joy. Comparison is the death to your joy. You just be you. You are special. There's no one else like you. You are very unique, created by God to be just you. You say, well, Dale, this 5-step plan that is outlined here in the book of Philippians sounds good, but how do I work it? I would really want to work the plan, but how do I do it? Well, look at this verse, Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Become an I canner. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Now, one of the scriptures I memorized when I was memorizing scriptures, started 2 years ago, was this one found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And this past week, I learned something that I hadn't noticed before. I learned the significance of that prefix in. You know, folks, I grew up not being in the in crowd. As a matter of fact, I could not even talk clearly until I was in the fourth grade. I stuttered and my words were just jumbled. I did not know how to talk. And so my dad put me in touch with a speech therapist. And you've heard the story before. I spent my lunch hours learning how to talk. And I took speech courses all the way through high school and college. But I never did feel like I was in the in crowd, because I was an introvert, to tell you the truth, in those early years of my character formation. And I was too shy to even ask girls out for a date. But I'm glad I overcame that, because I wasn't too shy to put my eyes upon Marianne. And God has provided just a wonderful, devoted wife for me. And we just celebrated 54 years of marriage. But I never did learn or focus on the significance of that prefix "and." I want to show you something. You know what? The devil may bring up your past, but because of the blood, it is inadmissible. And when we have a Father that includes us in His love, and we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and we have a promise that is indisputable that He will never leave us nor forsake us, and we have a name that is inerasable in Lamb's Book of Life, and we have a book that is inspired, and we have a body one day that is incorruptible, and we are going to receive a crown that's immovable, and we will have riches that are invested, and we have a promise that's inevitable that our God shall supply all of our needs according to His riches and glory, and we have a home that is indestructible. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, it was a great day, folks, when I realized that I'm in the in crowd, because I've anchored my faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, I'm a new creature. God's still working on me. He's not finished yet. But because I belong to Him, I am now in the in crowd. And so are you, if you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So, right where you may be watching this message, I would like for you to kind of break out in song. God is good all the time God is good. And then pray a prayer, something like this. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here in our home, in my life. Flood this place, flood my heart with Your Holy Spirit. You are welcome, Lord, into my life. And for all You do, we are going to give You praise. And that just may cause a shout from your lips and your heart. I trust that you will have the discipline to work these five steps. And if you do, you will learn, as I have learned and am learning, this is how you deal with anxiety and stress. This is how you can put a handle on your stress, by working these five steps. So, go to work and see what good things God will bring into your life when you make Him Lord of your life.